good evening again for those who are just joining in. Good to have all of you. We're back on Zoom, and indeed, we never even thought that we would have jumped back on Zoom altogether so quickly. And so, nevertheless, we are going to get into it today. And what we're doing is we're wrapping up this session, wrapping up for today on this series of the Day of the Lord. Now, before I share my screen, you would have realized that the Day of the Lord affects two categories of persons, the unbelievers and the believers, all right? It's Jesus's day, yes, where he shall reign supreme, where he shall rain down his wrath, where he shall also just let his glory be seen and felt and all of that. So it affects, in terms of humanity, two categories of people, the unbelievers and the believers. So when it comes to the unbelievers side, if you notice, the Day of the Lord is not good for the unbelievers. The Day of the Lord is not good for the unbelievers. I repeat that because you need to understand it. It's not a positive thing for the unbelievers. Unbelievers, the Day of the Lord is going to be sheer destruction and devastation and wrath and judgment for them. So we're wrapping it up this evening, and if you want to put what I'd call a tab or a handle on this Day of the Lord series, you will realize that it will affect two groups: unbelievers, judgment, wrath, destruction, devastation. All of the unbelievers that have been wicked and so forth, God is going to use these series of the Day of the Lord to judge them in different ways. So we looked at the nations being judged and all of that. We just went through that. But then you would have seen much earlier, maybe a month or so ago, where the Day of the Lord will affect the believers. And it has, when it comes down to the Day of the Lord affecting the believers, it has two effects on the believers, good side and bad side. The bad side, we would have talked about who that God is going to judge on some believers for, you know, the things they have done wrong and, you know, sins committed. And he's going to also judge some Christians, judge some of Israel. So there's a bad side for the believer and a good side for the believer. But when it comes down to the unbeliever, there's no good side regarding the Day of the Lord. It's just simply one-sided destruction, devastation, judgment. It's all bad for the unbeliever. The believer, however, which should benefit more, would have a bad side, and we talked about that, but they also have a good side. And so there are many blessings that will unfold for the believers during the Day of the Lord. So today I want to conclude on a good note, because we've been looking at devastation, we've been looking at all kinds of things. We've been looking at nations that were uprooted, nations that will be abolished and just disintegrated, so to speak. These nations will never be seen again. Their existence will cease. Their existence will cease. So how we're going to end, you know, let's end on a good note with this Day of the Lord series. We're wrapping it up. It says here, the Day of the Lord for many believers will be a day of rejoicing and rewarding. All right? For those of you who are just joining us, we are wrapping up the series on the Day of the Lord. We're ending it today, and we're ending on a good note. At the end of this little part here, we will just do what you call a recapping of some things, all right? So the Day of the Lord for many believers will be a day of rejoicing and a day of rewarding, all right? For the unbelievers, not so. Very different outcome for them. But for the believers, many believers, the Day of the Lord is going to be pleasant, delightful, a day of rejoicing and rewarding. And the following verses that I will be projecting will sanction that, will prove that. All right, so first of all, Philippians 2 verse 16, Paul writing to the church at Philippi, he says, holding forth the word of life that I may rejoice in the day of Christ. Notice the term is not day of the Lord, but it's still Jesus Christ, and it's still the Lord is still Christ, and Christ is still Lord. So it's interesting that the phrase is used there, not as the strict sense of Day of the Lord, but it means the same idea of Day of Lord, Day of Christ. So it says, holding forth the word of life that I may rejoice in the Day of the Lord. And why does he use that phrase, that I may rejoice? Rejoice in the day of the Lord about what? Notice he says that I have not run in vain, neither labored in vain. So when he uses these last two phrases, he says that I have not run in vain. That meaning I have not lived my Christian life in vain. I have not lived this life for the Lord in vain. What I do for him, it will not be burnt up. What I do for Jesus Christ will not be counted as lost. And then he says, neither labored in vain. And of course, he's speaking to the ministry. Paul, as you know, an apostle of Jesus Christ, went all out for God when he got saved, and he never stopped until his death. And so he says, I am going to rejoice on that day when Jesus Christ, when I meet him. All right. So can somebody tell me why would he rejoice on that day? The answer or the clue or the hint is in the statement I made in the first slide. The day of the Lord will be the day of rejoicing. And why would he rejoice? Anybody? Why would Paul rejoice in the day of the Lord? What is he hinting at? Anyone?
Sorry, I think being with the Lord.
Yes, but there is more to it. I gave you guys a hint in the first slide. There is more to it. I said that the day of the Lord is going to be a time of rejoicing, and another R word. Another R word. All right, so somebody typing there.
Oh, rejoice.
Yes, reward, indeed. Say, Alicia.
Okay.
Yes, so it's reward.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, being in God's presence is good, and he's going to enjoy that. I'm not saying that is a wrong answer, but at the same time, there's more to it than that. Let me back up again for some people who are just coming in. We are talking about the day of the Lord, and sorry, excuse me. We're saying that the day of the Lord, for many believers, will be a day of rejoicing and rewarding, all right? And they are going to be rejoicing because they will be rewarded, all right? So if you notice again, let's look at the verse again now when we put it into context. He says, holding forth the word of life, that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain, nor neither labored in vain. When somebody says to you that I don't want to work in vain, that means that they are expecting some reward at the end of it. And so that is what he's alluding to. The other three passages will bring it up, you know, but the idea is that Paul is indicating here that I have not lived my life in vain, nor worked for Christ in vain. I have not lived my life for Christ in vain, nor have I worked for Christ in vain. I'm going to rejoice on the day when Christ rewards me for living for him and working for him. So the day of the Lord, as we're saying, you're ending on a high note, a great note for the believer. It's going to be a time of rejoicing and rewarding, and mostly rejoicing because you're getting reward. We're going to be in the presence of God forever, and that, yes, is a point of rejoicing, and we'll be joyful. But we're also going to, if we worked hard and faithfully, the day of the Lord is going to be a rewarding day, all right? So we want to make sure that we point that out. Another passage which speaks to the same idea of rejoicing, which is 2 Corinthians 1 verse 14, says, as also ye have acknowledged us in part, that we are your rejoicing, even as ye also are ours in the day of the Lord. Now, 2 Corinthians 1 may not make too much sense, verse 14, might not make too much sense to you until you hear another passage that will bring it out some more. But let's look at it before we get into that other passage that will back this up. He says, Paul is saying to the church at Corinth. Remember that same church that them said is so sinful and so bad and had many issues. But you see, it is not about the perfection. At the end of the day, God knows that we are all still imperfect beings. And he is deciphering, and he will judge righteously, and he will judge right and give us what we deserve. If you don't do well, you don't get no reward. But if you do well, you will get a reward. So here is Paul telling them that you have acknowledged us in part, that we are your rejoicing, and even as ye also are ours in the day of the Lord Jesus. Now, when he says that we are your rejoicing, meaning that you're going to rejoice in us who have been ministers to you. And then the reverse is true, even as you also are ours. Paul is then saying to them, we are going to rejoice in you because you have been our converts. We are the ones that minister to you. We're going to rejoice with you. In other words, the people that we have led to the Lord, when we meet them in heaven, you see, one of the things that Paul didn't always get to meet all the people he impacted, he didn't get to meet all the people his preaching impacted and those who are led to the Lord. And as I say that, I must then mention this, that sometimes we have been privileged to lead some people to the Lord. We tell them about Jesus Christ and they say they want to be saved, and you lead them to the Lord personally. And let's say over your lifetime, you would have led 100 people to the Lord. You're expecting 100 returns, 100 converts. And then when you get to heaven, it would seem like there is going to be, what I'd say, some kind of indication of the souls that were saved under your ministry. And so while you would have led 100 persons, just giving a figure out there, while you have led 100 persons to the Lord, you might then find out that that is 10 times the amount that you would have impacted that got saved under your ministry. All right? So it might very well be 100 that you thought turns into 1,000 or 1,100 or 2,000 people. That is going to be a day of rejoicing where we have this song that we, Rainbow's song a long time ago, thank you for giving the Lord, I am a life that was saved. You never know the impact that your ministry has, reached. And so there's going to be a rejoicing, as that is what Paul is saying. You also are our rejoicing. We are going to rejoice in you. And we're going to back up that in a moment. If you think I'm stretching it too much, we're going to back it up in another passage. You are our rejoicing. We're going to rejoice in the converts that have been affected. And I will use these two terms, directly and indirectly. It's going to be a day of rejoicing when we see how our ministry impacted people. And that is why we should keep on serving the Lord. That is why we should keep on, if you feel like you're doing something behind the scenes and nobody not seeing you, you keep on doing it. You never know how you're impacting somebody else. If you feel like your ministry is not reaching, anybody, just do your ministry same way, whatever it is, because one day the impact will be seen. It would seem like that there's going to be a heavenly creating of that moment for that. So, without saying anything else, let me back that up with scripture. And some of you know the passage already. All right? So here goes. 1 Thessalonians 2, verse 19 and 20 says, for what is our hope or joy or crown of rejoicing? What is our hope? And then it says, or what is our hope? What is our joy or our crown of rejoicing? Are not even ye in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ at his coming? And then he says, verse 20, for ye are our glory and joy. He says, this is clearly stating that what really you think we're hoping for, what you think is going to make us happy, what you think is going to be our crown of rejoicing, it is seeing you people that I have been ministering to being in the presence of the Lord. It means that because of somebody giving to the ministry of the Lord, the gospel ministry, and telling somebody and leading somebody to the Lord, preaching, singing, teaching, whatever it is that you would have done to help to persuade somebody to make a decision for Christ and become a convert, Paul is saying that is going to be the greatest form of rejoicing, to see converts in heaven. And some people think the crown of rejoicing is literal, while some think it's symbolic. What one way or the other, we will all see. Because one thing we are certain of, there are literal crowns that are mentioned that you will get. And so this is one of them that most of us take literally, that we will get a crown, and we call it a crown of rejoicing, meaning the idea of the people we lead to the Lord, a crown for witnessing, a crown for evangelizing. And Paul is making it very clear that this will be joyful. This is our glory. You, converts, are our crown of rejoicing. So the day of the Lord, he mentioned it, are not ye in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ at his coming? And that is referring to the idea of his day, which was mentioned. Let me back up for you to see, right? We are, I'll back it up enough. So you can see 2 Corinthians 1 verse 14. And then I'm going to put back 1 Thessalonians. It says, we are your rejoicing, even as ye also are ours in the day of the Lord Jesus. And so 1 Thessalonians come and says, no, what is our hope? What is our joy? Or what is our crown of rejoicing? It is you that would have made it to heaven at his coming. And that phrase, at presence of our Lord at his coming, is referring to the day of the Lord, because the day of the Lord, one of the events is his coming. And one of the events is standing in his presence when we will be rewarded. All right? Any questions? Any comments? Any questions? Any comments? All right, none whatsoever. So guys, this is where we want to, what you'd call, capsule, you know, put an icing on the cake for the day of the Lord. The day of the Lord will end well for believers. It will not end well for unbelievers, but it is going to be good for believers. And so I trust that this will be an encouragement to us, even on the note that we're ending on, that it will be an encouragement to us to keep on working, keep on serving, because God is going to reward us and we are going to rejoice over those rewards. And so don't let anybody stop your progress. Don't let anybody stop your ministry. You keep on serving God, because Jesus is going to have his day and he's going to have you share in his day of rewarding and rejoicing. All right? So I thought the best way to conclude, which is the last slide we're going to look at, was to just simply recap with this. In the early part, a few months ago, when we started the Day of the Lord series, we brought this to the table, and some of it never made any sense to us. But we're bringing it back now, having looked at the various events, to see this is by no means an exhaustive list of all of the events of the Day of the Lord, but it encapsulates many of and most of the events that will take place in the Day of the Lord. So we're going to conclude by just simply looking back at it and to just simply make some quick comments. So the Day of the Lord is a phrase that occurs 24, even more times than that. It's just that sometimes not this exact strict phrase. The Day of the Lord Jesus, all right? So over 24 times in the Bible, and refers either to God's judgment on nations or to a future day when Jesus returns and God enacts his final judgment on humankind. Now understand that we just said that that judgment doesn't have to be bad. Judgment is God looking at what you did and he can reward you for it if you did well. Judgment is also God looking at what you did, and if you didn't deserve anything for it, you will lose something. So the judgment doesn't have to be bad. And I said to you that, believers, there are going to be some good moments for the day of the Lord. So some of the events that we're just recapping and capsuling that will take place on the day of the Lord is that God, full of fierce anger, will destroy Babylon on this terrible day. And this is test time. I'm going to ask you questions. You know, we're recapping you. So what is modern day Babylon called? What is Babylon called today? What is the country? Anyone? This is fresh information, you know.
Iraq,
very good. So you can very well.
Iraq.
The Iraq with the Q, right? Iran, God will use Iran to judge Iraq. So guys, get this in your head. The Babylon that was talked about is Iraq today, all right? That's where the old city is located, right in Iraq. So God is going to destroy Iraq. He has plans for certain nations in particular. Let's go down the line of the clouds here. God is going to destroy Judah with an invasion of locusts on this day of darkness and gloom. Now, remember, we've talked about this already. We looked at the judgment of Israel and so forth. God is going to weed out the bad apples in Judah. He's going to take care of some people in Judah and in Israel. You're going to see some of them dying. But he always, always reserves a remnant. He never will totally demolish and destroy the entire, Israel. But he is going to judge some, and then he's also going to always have a remnant to be used. That is one of the major things that will happen in the day of the Lord. God's plan for Israel is going to be totally unfolded. Then God is going to punish a number of nations. We just looked at that the last time. And anybody remembers what Edom is today? God punishes Edom and other nations for their cruelty. What is Edom today? Anybody remembers? Descendants of Esau, and who, what place is that today? Edom. Nobody remembers?
Jordan.
Jordan. Very good. All right. Edom is Jordan today. So we are seeing that God is going to judge Babylon, which is Iraq. He's going to judge Edom, which is Jordan. Anybody can remember some of the other nations we mentioned last? I think it's last. What? Today's what? Wednesday? So last. Did you have church last Sunday? or Wednesday as well too? Anybody remembers any of the nations? Other nations apart from Iraq, Jordan, anyone come to mind? Anybody remember any more nations we looked at? Somebody typing here. All right, Ethiopia, very good, Sister Suzette. Yes, Egypt, very good. Egypt, Ethiopia, somebody Africa.
What about Syria?
Syria. Some of the African nations too, like Libya. Mr. Moran, you missed Sunday night service when we were talking about Turkey.
yes, I missed Sunday night, yes.
Yeah, we were talking about that. And so he's going to judge Turkey as well. And I forgot what the name, Lydia, I think the old biblical name for Turkey, as mentioned in one of the passages, was Lydia. And so old time, I remember correctly, old time Lydia, biblical days, is now Turkey. All right. So a number of nations God is going to judge, and he has specific plans for them. Sometimes he's going to use one nation to judge the other. Sometimes he's just going to totally just run over them with fire. Another time he's just going to, just do different things, but he's going to judge them specifically as well. And so some of them are specifically marked for special judgment. All right. And remember, this is all because these nations up to this day, many of them, of course, you always have a witness in every nation, but many of them in those countries are idolatrous. They do not serve the Lord God, Jesus Christ. They, and they turn from it. And the gospel is gone to them and they reject it. And God will just simply judge them for that. All right, the nations will fight against Jerusalem and plunder the city. They take half of the people into exile. If you remember anything about Zechariah 14, you will see a twofold thing happening. God is going to allow the nations to judge Israel, to plunder Israel. But at the same time, following a said passage later down, God is going to judge those nations and give back the remnant in Jerusalem their restoration, and Jerusalem becomes headquarters for worship. And so those are some of the things they looked at. There will be darkness at the same time and salvation. Darkness for some, destruction for some, but salvation for others. All right. And the day of the Lord is going to come like a thief in the night. We looked at the idea of his coming, the rapture and the return, the return to reign and rule. These are all events that occur in the day of the Lord. Then a battle will occur. In fact, more than one battles, but I guess this is quiz time, right now. Which major battle? Well, two major battles did we talk about a few weeks ago? Give me one and give me another. Somebody give me one and give me another. There are some two major battles that we talked about that fall on the day of the Lord. Shout it out, type it out, whatever you feel like doing. Two major battles that we talked about. I think it was in June, last month. All right. I don't hear anybody yet, tell me something to forget already. Hello?
Is it Omega?
Yes, Gog and Magog.
Gog and Magog.
Very good. And then I see Sister Susan type in the battle at Armageddon. That's right. So those are the two major battles. I'm not saying that there won't be others, but there are two major battles that fall on the Day of the Lord, and the Battle of Gog and Magog will be one, and then the Battle of Armageddon. Very good, guys. I'm testing you. We're wrapping up. We're on the right side of the clouds now, and we're just going down the line. God sends the sword to destroy Egypt on this day of clouds and doom for Egypt, the nations. All right? So we talked about that. We cited Egypt as one of them. And then God is going to judge Israel and send the people into exile on this dark day, but always have a restoration plan for the Israelites. God will send destruction on the people of Judah for their unfaithfulness. So we're seeing that. And then God sends the prophet. This is the one we want to correct. I remember when I would have said this earlier, a couple weeks back. But what did we discover about this one? God sends the prophet Elijah to prepare the hearts of parents and children before the coming of this great and dreadful day. Don't be afraid to disagree with this. It's not like the theologians are brighter than we are. What did we find out when we checked Malachi 4? That this Elijah thing prophet here, is this really true? Is this, what did we discover? Anybody remembers? Is this Elijah that he's going to resurrect? We found out, hinting at it, you know, we found out that that is not true. All right? That is not so. Some people have been, yes, I'm here. I'm listening.
No, it's not Elijah. Elijah.
Right. And so who is it? All right.
John.
John the Baptist, indeed. John the Baptist. And so that portion has gone already. And so here, this is where, if you guys remember Malachi 4, though, don't get confused. I always tell you that mixed up in some of these passages would have been things that were future, but then they happened sometime and past. And I said to you, almost every event of the Day of the Lord is future, meaning that has not happened yet. So that those verses in Malachi 4, verse 5 and 6 are things that would have happened, John the Baptist, but never happened yet. And then it did. However, how you then make the distinction between verse 1 to 4 of Malachi chapter 4 and verse 5 and 6 is that if you remember anything about verses 1 to 4, and it's popping up in my head without even looking into the scriptures, you can check it for yourself. It mentions the earth burning up. It mentions, you know, some places will be burning up with fervent heat. And so that is how you distinguish the difference between something future that has happened, John the Baptist, and then something future that has not happened yet. Verses 1 to 4 would cover that idea. And the earth burning up has not occurred yet. All right? So that would be what you call the Day of the Lord event found in verse 1 to 4. Always remember, as we conclude this series, that if you're a little stuck and trying to figure out, all right, is this future, past, is that happened already? You know, just look for the anomalies, look for the strange things, look for the things that are, I say, okay, when it says this, for instance, I'm making up, no, I don't have to make up anything. When it says that the moon will turn into blood and the stars will fall and all that, you realize, okay, that definitely not happened yet. So if you are a little confused, if you review the passages, all you need to do is to look at the anomalies, the strange things, and you ask yourself, has this happened yet? Has this world event happened yet? And when you get a no, then you know, so it's fitting perfectly with the Day of the Lord theme of future end time events that have not occurred yet. And one of them is Christ's return. And he's going to return in several ways and several times. The rapture, the returning of to reign and rule, and possibly, as I said, that there'll be another set, because the idea is that Matthew 24 makes some different things that we can't always put together, returning for like the elect and a different time and so forth. Nothing wrong with that, but as I tell you, we don't have to try to make all the dots connect and to try to categorize and make everything going chronologic. It's all right. He says it's going to happen. And if we can't figure out everything as to when and how many, he says it's going to happen. And there are going to be more than one returns, all right, of Jesus Christ. And that's one of the events of the Day of the Lord. And God will save those who believe in him. That's one of the, that we just talked about, that the idea of saving and then rewarding. The day of the Lord is going to be salvation and redemption for the people of God. And then God is going to destroy the earth and everything in it, and the heavens will disappear, meaning the stars and the galaxy. That is one of the day of the Lord events. The earth is going to be totally demolished, but then remember, he's going to recreate it. All right? So God will do some destruction, but God will also do some reconstruction and renovation. That, my friends, is the day of the Lord in a nutshell. All right, guys. Any final words, comments, questions before we wrap it up for tonight? That is the day of the Lord. Anything?
I have one question, Pastor.
Yes, it sounds like Sharon.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I'm hearing you.
Yeah. Right. So the day of the Lord will begin with the rapture.
Yes.
Okay. And end where?
You know why I'm laughing though, right, Charmian? Because I remember a few sentences back trying to tell you guys not to try to put everything in chronological order.
Maybe I wasn't here, but I mean, we probably don't know the in-between parts, but we probably know the beginning and the end.
Well, listen, the best thing I can tell you is I suspect the last event of the day of the Lord could very well be what we call the burning of the earth, destruction of the earth, and the renovation of it. Because on that day when he destroys and burns up the whole earth and the atmosphere, it must mean that that's the end of days and end of, you know, the world. That's the phrase that people usually use, the end of the world. So it would have been that very event, the end of the world, will be the last event, because on that day when he burns up the entire world, there'll be no, because we would have been taken out, and there'll be no human beings, no dog, no cat, no tree. He's gonna just destroy it. So we could very well make this just statement that it will be the destruction of the earth, and then he makes the new heavens and the new earth. Sounds fair to all of you? Because after that, nothing else is left. Because we're coming back down to live on the new heaven and the new earth forever with God. Good? Good question. Good question. All right? All right. Anybody else? Any other comment, question? All right. All right. Thank you so much for joining for this series on the Day of the Lord. I will, as usual, make sure that the PowerPoint is prepped and ready and will be uploaded to our church website, which you can retrieve there. Or if somebody really wants me to email it to them personally, I can do that by your request. All right. But generally, it is going to be fine-tuned and sent, uploaded to our church website, where you can have this information, this resource to use for future teaching. All right? So we're going to end this segment in prayer, and then we're going to segue into our prayer time. All right, let us pray. Lord, we thank you for enlightening us. We thank you, God, for your plan that you have for your people. We realize that there is another side to it, the day of the Lord. I realize that unbelievers are doomed if they don't trust you as their personal savior. I pray that unbelievers will wake up before it is too late and help us to warn them while we have our breath in us. God, we thank you for your word, and your word exposes so many things. What a Bible you have given to us that can tell us about the future. We really have no reason to be sitting back with our hands, you know, our hands and our face, wondering what is going to happen next. You have told us, even if we don't know all the chronology, you have told us what is going to happen with our world. And so it is up to us to be prepared. So thank you for your word, and thank you for sharing with us, dear God, these prophecies and these insights. You didn't have to, but you chose to share with us what you have in store for time on this world. So God, I pray that we will be prepared and get ready. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.